morning, everybody.
Awesome.
I'm very grateful that you're here. I know you have a lot of things to do, so I'm very thankful that you're here to listen to my talk, and hopefully I'll make it worthwhile. This is a topic that is very near and dear to my heart in terms of five skills to force multiply your technical talents. You know, you may be the most technically talented person, but these skills that I'm going to talk about today are so much important for you to force multiply, to get your point across, that is so much more important, okay? So let's get started. What feelings does this picture evoke? Beautiful, calm, serene, sitting by yourself, you know, maybe checking emails, maybe not, maybe working. That's not reality though. Most of the time, we end up working in a team, and hopefully that team is diverse. And when you are creating your solution, when you're creating your piece that fits as part of a bigger puzzle, what that means is you need to integrate that with other solutions or a bigger piece. And what that means is you need to talk to people. What that means is your code is gonna get reviewed. In an open source world, it's all the more important because anybody, literally anybody from any age, any gender, any cultural background could be reviewing and giving you feedback. How do you take that feedback? How do you resolve that feedback? How do you make progress? How do you make sure that the piece that you worked upon actually gets utilized in that bigger puzzle and starts becoming important over there? So those are the pieces that I'm going to talk about. The term soft skills really come from US Army, to my biggest surprise. 50 years ago or so, you know, when US Army was at war, there were multiple battalions fighting. And they realized the teams that, the battalions that were winning were not because of the hard skills or the gun skills, the machine skills that were given to them, but the way they were led. And so they coined the term, everybody's given hard skills, but the way these battalions are winning are the soft skills. And so that's really the genesis of how the term soft skills come about to be. So what I'm gonna talk about today are what are soft skills, and I'm gonna list the five soft skills, why they're important, why they're relevant. Non-technical skills, I mean, technical skills are, I'm a Java programmer. I'm a Kubernetes certified application developer. I have a certification in that and that area. I can solve technical problems. Non-technical skills on the other side are that are needed to work in a team environment. They are beyond your technical skills. They show your personality on who you are instead of your technical capabilities. How do you interact with people? How do you work with people? How do you accept feedback? How do you receive feedback? How do you give feedback? All of that. And you probably heard, culture eats strategy for breakfast. No matter what the strategy of your team is, no matter, you know, what you are heading towards, if the culture is not there, the strategy is not gonna succeed. And the people in your team are the ones that define that culture. So it's super important if you have the strategy, but have that culture as well. And by the way, these skills, because they are very inherent to who you are, they're hard to acquire. For a technical skill, sure, I can do a Java certification or a Kubernetes certification, and I can keep rolling with it. But how do you get these certifications in a soft skill? There is not a whole lot that is happening in the industry today. So I think the impetus is upon us, is a challenge upon us. How do we improve the significance and relevance of these soft skills? So if you think about, you bring your whole self to the company, what we know in terms of technical skills, this is the technical part of it. And who we are is the non-technical part of it. And you bring that what we know and who we are together to the team. And people ask, is it 70-30, is it 30-40, what is the percentage? I think it's 50-50. And if I were to go a bit on a skew, I would say non-technical skills are maybe 60-40. Non-technical 60 and maybe technical skills are only 40. Maybe 70-30 in some cases, depending upon which level of the organization you are in. So it's really important to have those non-technical skills. This is a statement from Netflix Job Culture. By the way, that is the link on the bottom left here, which talks about in our dream team, there are no brilliant jerks. I can imagine you probably have seen some of those brilliant jerks in your companies. They are a pain to deal with. Brilliant is what we know. Jerks is who we are. That's what it is. You know, that's exactly the point. And I've dealt with several of those brilliant jerks. It's been a painful experience, but you got to go through it. So, another data point. Forbes did a survey of the 10 skills that are required for the next 10 years. And these are the skills that they listed that are required over the years. And guess what? Out of those, 8 are non-technical skills, soft skills. It's not telling you that, oh, learn the Java language, learn the Python language. No. These are all about emotional intelligence. These are about how do you collaborate with others? You know, what are your leadership skills? Those are the things. And this is truly independent of where you are in the organization. All right, let's jump into skills now. The first skill I'm going to talk about is communication. That is probably the most important skill that you need, because as you are putting your idea across in a team, as you are giving it to others that, here is what I want to do, communication. If you think about it, pretty much everything in our life either fails or succeeds either because of communication or lack of communication. So this is a really important skill. And this picture truly captures, like, this is how the original idea on the top left was conceived. This is what was created at the bottom, and look at the phases in between, all because of lack of communication, right? So let's be very specific. I hope to give you techniques on how we can improve the communication. What I call this as mindful talking, okay? Now think about this. When you are in a communication, there is a talker and there is a listener. The talker has an intent in their mind, which says, this is what I want to communicate, this is my intent, and it is private in your mind. On the listener side, as you have communicated, there's an impact that lands on them. And that impact is again private to them. Because you had something in your mind, you give verbal, non-verbal cues, you say something, you know, while you're talking, maybe you were on the phone, the person on the other side didn't hear part of it. So the impact could be very misaligned with the intent. So you need to be very careful clarifying with the listener, this was my intent, was that the impact? Because oftentimes, if the intent and the impact are not aligned, that's where the communication breaks down. It's super important. And, you know, we are always talking in a room. If you're in a room on a Zoom call, whatever, right? We're always talking, even if when we are not using words. You can talk with just rolling your eyes up. That's talking. You know, you're telling that, oh, your bugs are always broken. Ah, and there you go. You're talking. But you could say that, hey, we need to fix the problem. So I think we're always talking, so make sure you clarify the intent and the impact are aligned. And usually when you are conversing, how many times it happens when somebody's talking, or put yourself in the same position, when you are talking and somebody's like, they're trying to interject you. What happens in this case is, they have probably not paid any attention to your last 10, 15 seconds of your conversation, because they are stuck in a point 30 seconds ago, and they're formulating their thought, trying to interject the conversation and jam their point in. This is the biggest problem with communication. Most people do not listen with an intent to understand, but with the intent to reply. I'm gonna put my point across, jam it right in there. What's the rush? Slow down, have that mindful talking, make sure you understand the intent. How do you make that happen? Well, that's where the art of reflective listening comes in. Reflective in the sense, truly in the sense of a mirror. Let's go back to the speaker and a listener analogy again. There's a speaker, there's a listener. You, as a listener, you are listening to what the speaker is saying. Your role really is to listen and paraphrase back to the speaker. It sounds like it feels like, it seems like there is absolutely no space for passing a judgment or an opinion during that listening phase. All you're doing is you're trying to soak in the information from the speaker so that you understand their point of view. And once you have understood that point of view, then you have all the right to put your point of view across. But the important part is, once you have understood the speaker, they're more likely to listen to you. But otherwise, if you keep interjecting in between every time, you have made them lose their train of thought, and the discussion has gone completely in a different direction than it was intended to. So the real goal here is, in terms of communication, be very mindful of when you are talking as a talker, and in terms of a listener, be very careful that you have really consumed the information from the speaker and really communicated. And paraphrasing is important. You don't want to be parroting over there. Second skill that I'm going to talk about is about adaptability. Darwin theory says survival of the fittest. What is the fittest? The strongest? The tallest? The longest? No, it is really survival of the most adaptable. There's a beautiful study on TEDx which talks about a doctor, you know, who studied 10,000 living organisms across the world. And she studied what is one factor that kept these 10,000 living organisms survive over thousands of years. One factor, adaptability. That is the only thing that they need. Because as they say, change is the only constant. Couple of legendary examples of people who adapted. Steven Spielberg, he was rejected from University of Southern California. Yeah, you can't do cinematic arts. Now, they have a building in his honor. Michael Jordan was a cut, rejected from his high school team. He adapted, turned out to be a good player. If these people would not have adapted, imagine the world without these two people. Let me give a personal example here. About 10 years ago, I wrote this book with my son on Minecraft modding with Forge. Well, the book was originally meant to be Minecraft modding with Bucket. And it is really targeted at 10-year-old kids who have zero programming experience, zero Java experience, but to get them started with Minecraft modding. So we wrote the book. 3 weeks before the book was to be released, DMCA, Digital Millennium Copyright Act, shut down the project. Because the maintainers of the project had a conflict, they shut down the project. And my son, who was 10 years old that time, is like, "Dad, is this how book writing experience goes?" I said, "Not exactly. But you know, you're probably getting it at the deep end." What we did, we adapted. We realized the bucket is there is no future right now. So we adapted. We literally rewrote the book in the next few weeks. From bucket to Forge, all the code, all the storytelling, everything was changed. And we were still able to release. The book was to be released in September. But we were able to release it in December. Otherwise, we would have been sulking in like, "Oh, bucket is down, we can't do anything about it." So adaptability is really a key here. Now, if you think about what is adaptability, as I said, change is the only constant. Adaptability really is being able to adjust to new conditions. New employee comes in, some employee leaves in, new tool comes in, new expense report tooling comes in, which is always a pain. That is the ability. How can you change yourself? How can you adapt? And it's super important to understand change is the only constant, as I mentioned earlier. So you really have to embrace it. There is no way you can back off from it. And oftentimes people get very uncomfortable with the change. And being uncomfortable with the change is super important. I mean, I do lifting on a regular basis. None of my workouts from day to day are same, because they say the only way to get stronger is changing your workouts on a regular basis. So if I did squats yesterday, maybe I'll do bench presses today. If I did barbell row yesterday, then maybe I'll do a pull-ups today. Because then varying that workout, your body is always in a state of shock and constantly improving. We all know intelligence quotient. Now, this is a commonly understood terminology across the industry. a new terminology that evolved over the last few years has been emotional quotient, that talks about how can you handle, you know, situations around you. A new terminology that is coming on board for the last couple of years is adaptability quotient. If you look at the Venn diagram of what these quotients are, there is a IQ on the bottom left, bottom right, EQ on the top, and adaptability quotient on the left. And in the middle is what you see is PQ, which is your personal quotient. So together, you got to think about it. What is your personal quotient? How are you comfortable with being uncomfortable? Can you adapt to the change? Really think in that language. So how do you improve your adaptability quotient, essentially? The ability to recover from a failure. By a show of hands, tell me anybody who has never failed in life ever. I am honestly a product of all my failures. This is what defines me. I have failed miserably so many times, but I just kept going. That grit, that perseverance, that resilience is what defines you, nothing else, because failure is inevitable. How do you unlearn and learn? Yesterday was a different tool, now is a different tool. How do I forget that old ways and learn in new ways? That problem-solving skills, that resourcefulness. You know, your org structure changes, now you're sitting on a different part of the org. How am I gonna navigate that org and get my objective done? My son is a basketball player. You know, he plays for his high school basketball team, and he plays in competitive leagues as well. I always keep telling him, do not feel sorrow for the results that you don't get because of the workout you didn't do. You need to make sure that you're putting in the effort, you are resourceful, you're putting in the effort, then you get the results. Either there are excuses or there are results. There is no other thing in between. You can keep saying, oh, the gym is closed, oh, I'm too tired, oh, I slept late. Those are all excuses. If you don't put in the effort, there are no results. I love this book, Who Moved My Cheese? It's a short story book, 90 page, small pocket guide. It talks about two mice, you know, who are in a cheese factory. They're nibbling on the cheese, and as they're nibbling on the cheese goes away, and then one of the mice puts his running shoes on, goes to the next cheese factory, and starts nibbling the cheese over there. The other mouse, he stays in the cheese factory, and he says, oh, the cheese is over, I'm not happy. The first mouse, cheese gets over there, goes to the next cheese factory, and so on. This mouse keeps cribbing, keeps complaining, oh, the cheese is over, I'm getting weak, you know, he gets famished. So read the story. But the essence is, if you do not change, you can become extinct. As the conditions around you are changing, be willing to adapt. So really, my tip two is active unlearn and relearn. Be genuinely curious about what you want to do, and then embrace the failure. Let's talk about third skill, super important. How many times in a day you think, on average, we're in a conflict? How many times? Shoot out a number. 10 times in a day? 100 times a day? They say 8 times an hour. 8 times an hour you're in a conflict. Oh, should I eat a bagel or croissant? That's a conflict right there. Tough conflict. Should I eat ice cream? Should I eat chocolate? That's a conflict again. Should I walk up the stairs? Should I jump up the stage? Always a conflict, right? So in 8 times an hour, on average, we are in a conflict. So let's talk about it. I love this podcast. I'm not a reader. I listen to a lot of podcasts. Hidden Brain is a podcast by NPR. Shankar Vedantam is the host. And Adam Grant is an organizational psychologist at UPenn, or Wharton's rather. And he came on that podcast and he talked about absence of conflict is apathy, not harmony. If you think there is no conflict, there is no discussion there at all. It's super important to have that conflict because that healthy, constructive debate is so critical. Think about Wright brothers. I was listening to this podcast, and they were talking about how Wright brothers, over 100 years ago, when they came up with the first idea of a plane, and these two brothers would fight like crazy during the day, and they would debate about the design of the plane. But at the end of the day, they would still sit down together because they were brothers, they would have a beer together. So that conflict is super important, is what allows you to make progress. Now, oftentimes, when we think about a conflict, we think in two terms. There is a task conflict or a personality conflict. Task is about what needs to be done, how it needs to be done. We agreed upon that the release is going to go this and this time, how the release is going to be structured, etc. Personality conflict is who's going to lead the release? Is it the right person? And so I think that's where you need to really peel the onion. Is it about the personality conflict, and is it about the task conflict? If it's a task conflict, I'm happy to jump in and resolve it. But if it's a personality conflict, I ask people to go take a walk. Go walk together. Go have a coffee together. Figure it out. I'm not going to resolve personality conflict. You're probably aware with the Tuckman's model. You know, it talks about forming, storming, norming, performing different stages of a team. Now, when you think about these different stages of team forming, the personality and the task conflict really evolves in the forming stage because you're really putting the team together. You don't know who the team members are. There are a lot more personality conflicts, a little bit of task conflicts as well. As you move to storming and norming phase, personality conflict starts to hide away. For a performing team, there are zero personality conflicts, or say minimal personality conflict. It's all about task conflict. So that's the beauty of it. That's why that team is performing. So I would challenge you, go look at your team, have this discussion. If there is a conflict, ask the question, is it a personality conflict? Is it a task conflict? And if it's a task conflict, let's resolve it. If it's a personality conflict, go for a walk, talk to people. Amitabh Bachchan is a big actor from India, and he talks about 10% of conflict is due to difference of opinion, and 90% is due to delivery and tone of voice. You could give the same message in a variety of ways. There's a bug in the release, let's fix it. Ah, this person always causes the bugs, oh my God, and there you go. Same message, how do you convey it? It could convey a very different intent and the impact, as we were talking about. And by the way, my wife reminds me of this every day. Any idea who made this quote? The problem is not the problem is your attitude towards the problem. Shut up. It's a fictional character from movies. This guy, we can learn from all kind of people, right? He's not an ideal in real life, but in the movie, he's pretty good. He would always get into problems, but always get out of the problem. And this is the approach you need to think about. That are you too closely attached to the problem as opposed to trying to find a solution? What is your attitude towards the problem? Are you really looking to solve the problem, or you're too mired down into the details? So pay attention to that part. So in terms of tip three, conflict resolution, task versus personality conflict, be very aware of your biases. And that's where your task and personality conflict, you know, becomes conflict for yourself. And watch your tone and delivery. I don't think as an industry, we talk enough about kindness and gratitude. So this is a super important skill, and you have to pay really special attention here. What is kindness? Kindness is basically an act of helping somebody without expecting anything in return. And gratitude is thankful appreciation of the act of kindness. So simple thing, you know, you are at the traffic light, your traffic light turned green, you let the person pass. A simple act of kindness. You met somebody in the morning, you shake hands, and you wish them with a smile, and you make a compliment that, oh, you're looking great today, or you're looking cheerful today. Somebody reviewed your code, you give them a compliment. Or somebody new to the org, you help them settle down in the org, you become their buddy, onboarding buddy. Simple acts of kindness, okay? Now, why kindness is important? Kindness really increases all these hormones in your brain, serotonin, oxytocin, dopamine, which are all happy hormones that makes it better, that makes you happy, improves your cardiovascular health. And the beauty about kindness is what goes around comes around. If you give a compliment to somebody, you feel happy because your dopamines are high. The person you have given the compliment to, they feel happy. And somebody else who's watching it, they feel happy too. So overall, the helper's high, and overall raising the level of happiness across the world is super important. It's very important that we are kind to each other. And it also helps you create that meaningful connection at work, because what you're doing is now you're being kind to others in your colleague, you're constantly paying attention to being kind. And in turn, it helps you reduce your pain and stress. It doesn't minimize the pain and stress, but it gives you the courage, it gives you the ability to deal with that stress better. And I'm not saying this is a medical cure, but this is, it really gives you the ability, by being kind, it gives you that happiness feeling. This was a survey done by Gallup across multiple generations. And as you can see, well-being is among the top two things that all generations across, they really expect. And by well-being, they really mean mental well-being and physical well-being. And this is super important because having that meaningful connection at work, by having that meaningful connection at work, it really allows you to bring that mental well-being. Randomactsofkindness.org is a website. I really go by that website. It really gives you a poster that you can put at your workplace as your desktop banner. And it really gives you different ideas on how you could be kind. If you're running short of ideas, take a look at that. My son, he did internship at Roblox last year. And he had that imposter syndrome that, you know, when I'm in the room, I see people who are very talented. I'm barely a sophomore. How do I ask questions? And he got into that mode. But then he realized others are not perfect and I'm not completely flawed. And being kind to yourself is so much more important. Actually, it's so much more important than being kind to others. Because if you are not kind to yourself and you are kind to others, you will have a burnout. It's more important, I would argue, to be kind to yourself first than to be kind to others. Because if you're kind to yourself, that thing starts spilling over to your friends and your family and everybody else. Yesterday would have been 95th birthday of Maya Angelou. And this is a statement that I live by every day. People forget what you did, people forget what you said. They never forget how you made them feel. End of the day, if you're talking to somebody 10 years from now, they will not remember, oh, that activity or that bug, et cetera. All they will remember is, that person helped me out, or that person was mean. Think back in your life, you know, 10, 15 years ago, if you met somebody, what do you remember about them? Do you remember them as a kind person or a mean person? I want to be remembered as a kind person. Let's do a workshop here, okay? So what we're going to do is, 15 seconds, pick a person to your left or to your right. If you don't have anybody, talk to them or figure out how you're going to pair. Give them a compliment. All right, time to switch. Now, switch the roles. The person who was getting the compliment now that person has to give the compliment back. 15 more seconds. Let's switch it. All right. Thank you, everybody. So hopefully your dopamine levels are up and you get out of the keynote happy. So what is kindness and gratitude? Practice kindness. Be conscious, be deliberate about it. At my team meetings all across, I've always done gratitude check-ins. All my team meetings always start with a gratitude check-in. And what that means is, oh, when this release happens, that's when we're gonna celebrate. We never think in that language. We always think about, because the team meetings are always Mondays or Tuesdays, what was the gratitude moment for you last week? Did somebody do good? Let's be thankful about it. And then at Intel, well, that's where I work, we also have this spot recognition concept. So at any point of time, we can send somebody a virtual card, you know, at different levels and recognize it. And be very conscious about giving compliments to people. That's what makes the world a kinder place. All right, this is the last skill. This is something that I have started picking up the last few years, and I've really enjoyed. It has really made me a lot more peaceful person within myself. What is mindfulness? Mindfulness is being present in the current moment without judgment. Oftentimes we are running, you know, our mind is thinking in different directions. How could you be present in the current moment? How could you be genuinely curious about the current moment? How could you make sure that you're not thinking about the past or the future? And oftentimes, that is exactly what is driving you away from the present moment. Guess what? The last breath you took is past. The next breath you're gonna take is future. The current breath is the current moment. How can you ground yourself in the current moment is so critical. What are the stories you are telling in your head about the past and the future that is getting you worried? Either you are worried about the past. Can you change that result? No. Can you predict the future? No. You can be better prepared for it. You can learn from the past. Neither of those are in your control. The only thing in your control is the current moment. So being present in the current moment and not saying, oh man, this moment sucks. That's without judgment. I saw a cartoon the other day. Oh, I like being present in the moment, not just the current moment. Only the moment when I'm on the beach. But it's important, live moment by moment, because that is the only thing in your control. Two perspectives of how do you define mindfulness. Michael Scott, you know, you probably know him from the sitcom Office. He didn't make that statement, but that is his approach. It is what it is. That's mindfulness, and we use that phrase all the time. But that is a very defeatist attitude, in my opinion. That is a very, oh, basically suck it up, this is how it is. So that's, it is what it is. Ajahn Sumedho is a Theravadian monk. He's a monk from Thailand. And he talks about, right now, it's like this. These five words, what really grounds me right away. Right now is the current moment. It's is not about me, it's the situation around me, like this. If you just think about it, over the last several years, I've said this statement so many times to myself. Right now, it's like this. What do I need to do to make progress? Neither the past nor the future is in my control. How do I move forward? Because right now, in the current moment, ground yourself, it's like this. Where can I be mindful? Pretty much everywhere. Anywhere and everywhere. eating, drinking, sleeping, running, talking, coding, code reviews, in a team meeting. Just be mindfully present. How many times it happens you're in a meeting and you're checking an email? Oh, can you repeat the question? Are you being mindful over there? You're not. Either be in the meeting or don't be in the meeting. See what value are you bringing to yourself or to the meeting. How many times you try to fall asleep, either you're thinking about how the day has gone by or the next day is gonna be, and you're planning that in your head. And that's where I have applied mindfulness multiple times, several times actually, over the last few years. I immediately start grounding myself in my breath, and that allows me to sleep much more calmly. And I'll talk about that in a second. Mindful eating is big. How many times you are just eating and watching a phone or a Netflix? Give yourself a moment. Look at the food. Enjoy the fragrance. Look at the color. Savor the food that is in your mouth. That is mindful eating. Be careful about what you're eating and why you're eating and how you are eating. All those elements, you could really be mindful anywhere and everywhere. Just like kindness, how mindfulness helps, you know, it increases your healthier relationships because you are deeply engaged in that relationship in that moment. As opposed to, you know, multitasking, you are focusing on a single task, it improves your focus and improves your memory as well. It gives you more cognitive flexibility because when you are in that task, you are more tuned to that task. It allows me to sleep better, and it decreases all the things on the right. Eating disorders is the one that I was talking about, mindful eating, which is very helpful. Now, the thing about mindfulness is it does not make the world around you perfect. It rather allows you to live in an imperfect world and in a much more contented way. Because the world around you is always going to be imperfect, no matter how you feel, because the world doesn't think like you. So mindfulness allows you to say, right now, it's like this, and that's how I'm going to ground myself. What are some of the techniques to be mindful? Breathing is a very common technique because that is the only thing that defines you. Every time you're feeling anxious or worried about the past, start breathing. You are breathing, but pay attention. Pay attention to your in-breath. Pay attention to your out-breath. Just start paying attention to that because that is always with you. Body scan is super important. You know, I've done body scans multiple times, and body scan really requires, I mean, you could do this over 5 minutes or 45 minutes. You could just lie down on a mat and start feeling from your head all the way down to your toes. Start thinking about it, start feeling. What am I feeling in my head? What are the feelings in my forehead, my eyelids, my eyes, my ears, my cheeks, my nose? Do that full body scan. Am I feeling tingling? Am I feeling hurt? Am I feeling pain? Am I feeling calm? Am I feeling relaxed? Do that full body scan. And there are a lot of body scan YouTube videos that you can take a look at it that will guide you through that full body scan, 45 minutes to an hour, or you can do a quick body scan in 5 minutes as well. Slow down, accept yourself. You know, be kind to yourself. One more workshop. This workshop will take, and I'm going to give you a timer here, okay? What we're going to do here is, this is what I call as box breathing, okay? Now, the way this works is, for 4 seconds, you're going to inhale. It's a slow inhale. Then you're going to hold your breath for 4 seconds. And please, I'm not a medical expert. Please don't do this if you cannot do this. Just a disclaimer right there. But the way I generally operate this is, you inhale for 4 seconds. You hold your breath for 4 seconds, then you exhale for 4 seconds, and then you hold for 4 seconds, and then you repeat. So in a way, it's taking 16 seconds for that one full breath. So in a minute, you can do 3 of those, okay? So think about this and time yourself. I'm gonna give you a counter, okay, ready? 3, 2, 1. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. That's one breath. If you are feeling ever worried, if you are ever feeling anxious, just do that exercise. It's a boxed breathing. And what that immediately does is, because your attention is on yourself, on your breathing, hopefully you're not breathing from the shallow lungs, from the deep lungs, you're giving more oxygen to your lungs, and that is what is helping you calm down right away. And that brings you to the current moment. This is a technique that I follow all the time, every time. This is a podcast that releases Monday, Wednesday episodes, 10% Happier. This is a podcast by Dan Harris. Dan Harris used to be a national TV broadcaster. He had a panic attack on the national TV channel. And so he started this company, 10% Happier. It talks about you don't need to be 100% happier. Even if you could be 10% happier, that'll be good. And he brings all meditation, mindfulness, kindness experts across the world. And I listen to this to all my runs, all my workouts. I just crave for these episodes. So tip number 5, live in the present moment and be non-judgmental. Don't put a label to yourself. In short, I would say people skills are really hard, but you really need to invest in them to force multiply your technical talent. Next time you are in a discussion, think about how could you be mindful talking, do a reflective listening. Next time you're in a conflict, think about how can I make it about task conflict as opposed to a personality conflict. Next time in your situation where you walked out of a meeting and you fail, be kind to yourself. Think about all the other times you have succeeded, be resilient, come out of it stronger. You know, be mindful whenever you're in a conversation. Think about all of those elements. Thank you so much.